Blog Talk Radio. Chatting with Nat is a podcast for independent women seeking to speak their truth and to break down barriers. We host honest conversations that help to guide and empower women. Speak your truth and set yourself free. Let your voice be heard.
Hi everyone, this is Natalie Dean. It's Nat. It's Natalie Jean. Yes, we're chatting with Nat, and today we have acoustic band Midnight Bouquet. Midnight Bouquet is an acoustic band based in Tuscany. Carmela Fiorello is the singer, and Alessandro Moschini is the guitarist. I hope I said that right. They formed Midnight Bouquet on February 2020 and released their first EP on May 2020. Music is their life. They like to play in many different genres, but they are specializing in bossa nova. They have talented musicians. They sing in Italian, English, French, Spanish, Portuguese, and play several string instruments, which is adding more to their flavor. So let's give a round of applause for Midnight Bouquet. Hi, how are you?
Hello, how everyone? Thank you for having us in your show. This is Midnight Bouquet. I'm the singer, Carmela Fiorello. And Alessandro Moschini is my partner, the guitarist.
All right, Carmela.
Yeah.
Oh, don't worry too much. It's okay.
No, I tried.
Don't worry, it's fine.
So how have you been during the pandemic?
Well, the thing was, unfortunately, we couldn't play our music, but
right.
We did, you know, we had a lot of home performances and video recording, so we could share anyway our performances online and on major platforms.
Okay.
Because we didn't want to just stay, you know, waiting.
Right.
We didn't know for how long, so we had this idea to try to stay tuned with our public, let's say.
Right.
And
right.
So having these home performances and trying to stay focused on our music, basically.
That's really good. A lot of the people that I've interviewed, yes, they, you know, everybody was home. They tried to do a lot of performances.
Yeah.
The house, you know, do some live streaming. I did some live streaming. Live streaming is very interesting. Sometimes you can have many people. Sometimes you can have a few people. Sometimes you're singing to yourself. But
but just in case, you're having fun and showing your performance, so it's fine.
And then it allows you to keep practicing your music. Sometimes I can't remember my own lyrics. I have 90 songs.
Exactly. We were scared to keep for a long time, so we just didn't want to wait. So that was why we decided to forward all of these recording from home.
Yeah, which makes a lot of sense. It's a good use of the time since we were locked down.
Yeah.
Italy was locked down for a longer period and a lot of devastation. So I'm sorry to hear about that. So during the pandemic, a lot of people, a lot of the artists that I've spoken to say, you know, this was a time for a lot of self-reflection, you know.
Yeah.
They had time to think about who they wanted to be as artists. You know, some of them changed their ideas about what they were going to write, what they were going to sing, what they were going to perform,
how
they were going to be as artists. So during this pandemic, did you have a time to reflect about how you want to be perceived as an artist?
Yeah, exactly. We tried, you know, to think about what we wanted to do, like in a long period of time. So in the next future, we just want to do, of course, always our best.
Right.
We wanted to try for this new. I mean, we like many genres, as you said,
right,
at the beginning. But we are trying to go towards a specific path,
okay,
which is the bossa nova, which we know it's very difficult, yeah, for playing and singing, because it's a very difficult language, Portuguese, which unfortunately we didn't have the chance so far to study in deep, but we are little by little studying, because we understand that this language is perfect,
right,
for the kind of music. So the way that expresses the feelings of happiness and sadness and everything is very soft, and we think it's very good for this type of music.
I love bossa. Bossa nova is very hard, like you said.
It is, yeah.
When you're singing in a different language. But it's a cool genre. It's a very cool genre. And if you can do it, you know, I applaud you. So how would you describe your music? How is your bossa nova different than anybody else's, if it's different?
Well, honestly, we are very humble, and we are learning from the big masters, you know. But we are still at the beginning, but we want to improve and do our best, trying to, you know, following, of course, the big names of belonging to this music. But we'll try to also to have, you know, our own specific personal
right,
style, if possible, because of course we respect this genre, because as you said, it's very difficult, and so we are humble about it. So we little by little, step by step, we want to try to go towards this path. But in the meantime, you know, we are loving other genres like rock, and so we did our, you know, our first EP also shows that we love a different type of music as well.
Okay. How did you get into the music business? Was there something that you were watching? What moment in your life were you like, oh my gosh, I have to sing?
Well, personally speaking, I mean, I always loved singing, but it took me some years to recognize that I had a quite a decent voice, because I was very scared to sing in front of a public. But then, you know, I said, you know what, why not? Maybe I can do this. And then I said, all right. But it took me ages, to be honest, to find a good player like Alessandro that could, you know, have the same taste for music like me, and, you know, having patience also.
Right.
And
right,
so that was the good timing at the door, as you said, the right place at the right time sometimes, you know?
Yeah, I am like you. When I decided to, I didn't even know that I could sing. So, you know, I started late in life to start my career. I started my career, I would say, about 10 years ago. In the music business,
okay.
I was very shy, and I would say to myself, oh my God, I don't know how I'm going to sing in front of people. And
yeah,
then after a while, I started to not care about what people thought. So I had to get into my head that, you know what, I'm just going to give a good performance. I'm going to give love to the audience. And then when I started to think about it that way, you know, then I wasn't scared to perform, because I'm just like, we're going to have a good time. And people are going to enjoy it, and then that's it. So
I totally agree. Yes.
Yeah, that's the cool way to me being scared. How did you meet Alessandro?
Well, it's a funny story because at the time we basically met on Instagram, like it usually happens sometimes. But at the time I was still living in London, and because it's a part of my life, I lived for about 5 years in London. And then I don't know how he contacted me, like for some music video, something like that. I can't remember at the moment, to be honest. And then I said to him, you know, you're quite good. I actually, when I come back, if I'm coming back for good in Italy, I need someone to play for me because I don't know where to start again because, you know, it was a long time that I was in Italy. So he said, no problem. When you decide to come back, you contact me here and we'll see. So that's what I did. But it took me some time because at the meantime, when I came back, all the process, you know, to be back home and documents and stuff like that, you know, all the procedures. And then when I contacted him, he said, you know what? Okay, we can meet and see what you like. What is, for example, what's the genre that you want to do? And so like this, we started to meet, and that's the story so far.
Basically. Instagram, all these different social media platforms, it's a lot of work, but at the same time, we can meet many great people to collaborate, get on podcasts and stuff like that. So that is fantastic. So
thank you.
What is your writing process like? So how do you come up with a song when you're writing it, the music part and the lyrics?
Well, basically, this is the part which Alessandro maybe can explain better because he's the head for the lyrics and music. So maybe he can explain it for better than me. Yeah, I will pass it to
you. Thank you. But normally, when I play at home, if I find a good riff that I like, normally I record it, okay? And and sometimes, if I don't have the idea immediately, I freeze the riff into the recorder until I have the good idea to express. Then I write before the music and then the words. Sometimes I write in English, sometimes in Italian. Sometimes when I write in English, I tell Carmela to read the English to find errors because she's better than me in English. So she's the expert.
All right.
So who
are your musical influences? Who are the artists that you like?
Me or Carmela?
Both of you.
Both of you. It's not easy to do a restricted choice of it because I listen to many genres of music, many bands, it's so many songs, so many artists that I like. But basically, for example, in bossa nova style, for sure, Antonio Carlos Jobim or Toquinho, for example, João Gilberto. I love also rock and some other kinds of music. And also in our repertoire, we have also songs not born as bossa nova, maybe rock songs rearranged in bossa nova. Because we like the sound expressed when we rearrange the songs.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Okay. This question is for Carmela. You know, in the United States, you know, a lot of women were still fighting to be seen and heard in the music industry. You know, it's always the men in the front, the women in the back.
Yes.
But we're making progress. Is it that way in Italy?
Well, it's a good question. Well, I know it's difficult, but I guess that we all have the same rights, so everyone should have the same opportunity to be heard and seen equally. So I think it's music should be the good link for everyone to be heard and seen properly, finally, you know, at last, as you say.
Here in the United States, you know, there are many female producers, mixers, engineers, writers, and stuff like that. But it's not until recently where, you know, women are being applauded or being seen as these things, because it's always they put the men in the front. Like, for example, country music, for a long time, they would only play one female and they would pay 50 men, one female on the radio station. So now that's changing. A lot of women, a lot of people, I said, okay, this is not fair. So now they're changing a lot of things. So that's how it is over here. I'm going to play your song, It's Monday. What is that song about?
Oh, this song is about, finally, we thought about the, you know, Monday is actually an underrated day of the week. Because people think about, oh, you know, finally it's the weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But as of course, many other people, a big group of people, they just work on the weekends and they have a day off Monday on Tuesday. Us, for example. And so we said, I think we, basically Alessandro said, I think we should, you know, give a chance at Monday to be good again, you know, because also Monday can be your day off, so you can relax, read a book, just caress your cat on your sofa, just relax, take it easy. And Monday can be, you know, a good day as well.
We love cats. By the way,
yeah, we are cat lovers. Yes.
I'm glad because I've had five cats, but I had a cat.
Oh my God, beautiful!
In 2012 and 13, I had two cats that died. I had them for about 12 to 13 years, and then I got another one, and he only lived to be 8 years old. He died last year in November, which is very
sorry to hear that. Yeah.
Very hard. And then I got two kittens in December, and their name is Michael and Faith. I forgot what it's like to have kittens, because I haven't slept because they're running all over
I love
them.
Nice. That's
very
lovely cute. And they keep you, you know, still.
Yeah.
They have this magic thing that they keep you always happy and loved, so it's very nice.
We wrote the words of It's Monday, we love so much the cats that we decide we want a cat inside our song. A cat, it has to be a cat inside the song.
I love that because I actually wrote a song. I have two songs that are about my cats. One is called I'm Not Ready. You know, when the cat died, I wrote that song. And I wrote You Are My Everything, which is a Janet. A lot of people, when they hear it, they think it's about somebody I've dated. And I'm like, no, it's about my cat. So and I put my cats on TikTok. They're on TikTok. So I've had a lot.
Yeah, lovely. Yeah, I know. They're such special creatures. So we agree. Totally agree.
Right, well, I'm going to play It's Monday right now, but we're going to have a word from our sponsor.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, this is Nikki Chris, and I host a podcast called Mixin' It. Mixin' It focuses on women in the music, entertainment, and the performing arts. Our goal is to provide an avenue for industry veterans and up-and-coming artists, musicians, engineers, and producers to showcase their talent. Listen to Mixin' It on Monday Music Madness at 8 p.m. Eastern on the Sim Radio Network.
That was beautiful. Very beautiful.
Oh, thank you so much. Did you like it?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, no, I love it. Very, very soothing. You have a very soothing voice.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate from you. Thank you.
You're welcome. So what do you love about being an artist?
Oh, me personally, I like the fact that people can see me, my personality, and not only how I look outside, of course, but also what I want to express, my feelings. I like the way that when I sing, someone can understand properly what I mean. It's not
right.
Some people are, I don't know, some singers are really talented and they can sing very high notes.
Right.
But I don't know, somehow I don't feel like any specific emotion. I don't know.
Right.
But so I try, like as I can, of course, to give some emotion and try to pass the feeling that I'm trying to say by the words that I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a hard job, but
yeah.
I'm doing my best. So this is what I like. I like to be like performing in this kind of way, like hoping that some people, when they go home, they say, oh, my God, you know, I really enjoyed. I have something that I will remember, you know, somehow. That's my hope, actually.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And a lot of artists are like that. You want you want to be an effective player. You want your music or your voice to have an effect on the audience. You know, it's just not about making money, but you want to make sure people are happy. You know, you'd be surprised. There are not a lot of artists that are like that. You know, it's okay to want to chart and make money and do all these things, but sometimes what is important is that we're making a difference in somebody else's life. You know what I mean? And that
we do our best to do this. Yes, I know it's difficult, but yeah, this is what we would like to to do. Yes.
Yeah. We understand that. Now, what do you prefer when you are performing? Do you prefer an intimate setting or do you like a large crowd? Which do you like better?
Well, it depends on the situations, I guess. But I usually like more an intimate location or like, you know, something that a place or somewhere, a location where people, we are all like together. And so that we can, you know, you can see me and I can see you,
right.
And we feel the same thing at the moment, so I can have a connection somehow,
right?
But it depends. If you sing something like more rock kind of songs, maybe also a bigger audience, it's nice, so you can, you know, play a little bit more and like this. So in the sense that you can joke, you know, mimic somehow. So, yes, but for myself, for my type of voice, I think I prefer a smaller audience somehow. Yeah. Even because we are, you know, acoustic duo. So maybe for us, it would be better to be heard properly, because you know we just have ourselves and microphones, so we don't need much more to be heard. So it's basically this.
No, I understand. I get it. Yeah, I love an intimate setting because you can connect with an audience better. But sometimes when you have a large crowd, you can have a lot of fun with a large crowd as well. It's nice to see all those people together.
Yeah. It really depends on the situation, I think. Yeah.
And, you know, in this music business, it's a lot of work. You know, we have to promote ourselves. We have to try to get bookings. We have to write songs. We have to spend a lot of money. So how do you manage all of your social media platforms? Because I know it drives me crazy, because, you know, I took a webinar on and TikTok. They want you to do 5 videos a day. I don't have time for that. But
no. Yeah. Yes. I think there should be the good, you know, a good, not, you shouldn't live on social media, but at the same time show yourself so people don't forget about you. But it should be the right measure. I don't know, not too much, not too little.
But the problem is, for us as musicians, you constantly have to be on there. Like you said, you know, you don't want people to forget you. And in doing all of these music conferences over the past year through the pandemic, because there were like 500 of them, millions of them, they tell you have to keep saying something. Because one of the things that I've learned, especially in the pandemic, is that people are craving authenticity. They want something that's real. They want to be able to relate to the artist.
Yeah.
You know, they want that, oh my God, this artist really gets me. Oh my God, I love this song. It really speaks to what I'm going through at the moment. And then that's that moment they said, oh, I have to follow that artist. So we constantly have to be on the social media platforms, which is kind of sad, because, you know, sometimes being on that stuff is too much. You know, I will sit down.
No, I totally agree with you. Yeah, sometimes it's too much. Yeah, it should be, we should find the right way, you know, to be there, but not live on there, you know. Well, personally, us, we do our best to, but we don't, to be honest, we don't live there, but we try to keep on posting when we have something which is good, not just because we have to and we want to give good stuff anyway, so not just to be there. So maybe we are not so constant every day, but when we put, like, I don't know, once a week, once a we put good stuff. So we try our best to for this. The social media part is usually Alessandro who plays for the, who does this part usually. Yes.
Okay.
Practically, during the pandemic, in the beginning, I have tried to contact locals or festivals to play live after the pandemic is over.
Right.
Okay, but I understood immediately that the pandemic took a long time. So we were in lockdown at home. It was not possible to play live. So I thought to invest the time that I was home for the promotion on the internet. Okay, practically on Facebook and on Instagram, I have come in touch with many everywhere in the world.
Right.
That had some many playlists done by themselves, and we exchanged our songs with. I put one of my songs, one of your songs in my playlist. You put one in mine,
right?
And we have created a web of artists. Nobody has lost something, but everyone has earned a larger audience everywhere.
Right.
We have learned many clever artists, and we have enlarged our public. Practically like that.
No, that's very good. That's very smart. I mean, one of the major things that a lot of artists try to get on is playlists. Here in the United States, I mean, in the music industry, period, it is best to get on a really good playlist because that's where you're going to be seen and heard. I mean, I have a couple, we have a couple for the Sisters in Music. I have a couple of my own that I've created. One is called Country Pop. That has over 200 people on it that have submitted to my playlist. I've been on a couple of other people's playlists. But yeah,
yes.
that is one of the hardest things to get on really popular playlists. There's a thing called the Indie Bible, and you can purchase it, and it's just about all the playlists on Spotify.
Yes.
It allows you to contact all the playlists that you want to see if you can get on there.
Yes.
It's
consider that on Spotify, where I found in one playlist the contact of the curator, I have contacted everyone.
Yeah.
Some have added our songs, some didn't answer, but anyway, I tried to contact anyone. You know, it can happen. Someone answers to you and some not. But the important is to be constant persist in your work.
Definitely. What is one thing you wish you had known when you began your career in music?
That's a good question. Yeah, maybe that you need to be patient, you need to keep your goals, and sometimes you shouldn't listen to people saying, oh, where do you go, why you go and sing, why don't you get a proper job, or you say, oh, you're going to lose money and time, and then you're going to be upset with yourself because this doesn't get you anything, you know? So sometimes you just should believe in yourself a little bit more.
Right.
And so, and because, you know, people, if they want, they can judge you anyway. Even if you're perfectly fantastic, doesn't change anything. So you need to believe in what you can do and try to do your best always, improve yourself, but never let people let you down, because it's so easy to say, okay, maybe you're right and I should let it go. It doesn't, you know, it's not worth it. And yeah, there's million people that maybe are more talented than me, yeah, and maybe, but you know, it's so easy to say that. But
yeah,
so maybe somehow you should say, you wish someone telling you, you know, you're worth it, but you should believe it yourself first. So,
right. You believe in yourself. Yeah. No, I totally agree.
Yeah. It's an easy point, but it's not so easy, because it's a hard work to to be constant and say, it's okay, you know, I want to do this. And yeah, like that. So,
I agree. 100%. I'm going to play your song, Love is a Losing Game. What is that about?
Oh, so as you know, it's a beautiful song from Amy Winehouse, which is an artist that we loved and unfortunately left us too early. And what I love about this song is the lyrics, because it's a song which is different from the standard structure of a song. So usually you have, you know, lyrics and then you have a chorus and blah, blah. This is like a kind of, it's a poetry with the rhymes. And mm-hmm. I always love the way it sounds. The choice of the words that she choose, I think it's beautiful in itself. And also I love because we like her as an artist. So it's good for my type of voice and everything. So I said, we want to humbly trying to have a cope, and that's how it worked. I hope that you like it.
Okay, hold on one sec.
Love is a losing game.
That was very good. I love your interpretation of that song. Very smooth.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
What advice would you give to somebody that's trying to get into the music industry?
I'm trying to say, just be yourself. Don't try to be like to play like somebody. Just try to be yourself. Follow your personality, and don't imitate. I don't know if it's the right verb to say that. Just be yourself, because sometimes industry needs people that are just genuine, just themselves, and not imitating or trying to be pretending someone else. So, and try to do their best.
Yep, no, I agree with you. You know, there's so many artists that, you know, they want to try to mimic their favorite artist, which is fine, but I think people will appreciate more music more when you're showing your authentic self. I think authenticity
yeah.
yourself is fantastic. I think a lot of people are afraid to be vulnerable.
It takes some courage, to be honest, to be themselves. But you need to do. Otherwise, it's just another one on a million, you know? It's more difficult to come on the surface, maybe.
Exactly. Because I know in the United States, when you turn on the radio, it's also almost sounding like you're listening to the same artist over and over and over again.
Yeah.
You know, and as I grow as an artist, what I listen to more are people's lyrics. I want to see how deep that artist is, you know, how they're trying to convey a message that will really help other people.
That's one of the reasons why I started to learn English when I was little, because I wanted to learn the lyrics and to see what these artists have to say. So I started from zero, and music helped a lot. So thanks to the music.
That's right.
Which is everything, yeah.
So what is one quote or message that you like to live by?
Well,
I think that the message is love what you do.
Love what you do. Amen.
Be yourself and love what you do without compromise. Because I think that the artists that remain are the ones that are genuine, not the a product of the music industry, a pre-product artist, ecco.
Right. No, I agree 100%. It's very important, muy importante, to be real and authentic. Yes, I agree with you. Well, thank you, Carmela.
Thank you so much for having us. We really appreciate your time, attention, and the time that you gave us for your show. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed.
Anytime. I will continue to follow you on Instagram or wherever you are. You have.
Thank you. And maybe we can see us again when we have something new, maybe in the next future. Who knows?
Yeah, and let's do an IG live, an Instagram live, where you can play on Instagram. We can do that one day too. That will be
okay. We keep in touch and we see what we can do.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much indeed. Okay.
All right, everyone.
Bye. Thanks.
Bye.
That was Acoustic Band, Midnight Bouquet, the phenomenal Carmela and Alessandro. Please follow them on Instagram. You'll find them on as Midnight Bouquet. Until next time, this was Chatting with Nat.
Chatting with Nat is a podcast for independent women seeking to speak their truth and to break down barriers. We host honest conversations that help to guide and empower women. Speak your truth and set yourself free. Let your voice be heard. Love your power.